الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على المبعوث رحمة للعالمين وعلى آله وأصحابه ومن تبعهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين وبعد فقد قال الله تبارك وتعالى في القرآن المجيد والفرقان الحميد أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم النار يعرضون عليها غدوا وعشيا ويوم تقوم الساعة أدخلوا آل فرعون أشد العذاب وقال النبي صلى الله تعالى عليه وسلم يبعث كل عبد على ما مات عليه المؤمن على إيمانه والمنافق على نفاقه أو كما قال عليه الصلاة والسلام Honorable scholars, respected brothers and elders, one of the most significant organs and lungs of the human body, both physically and spiritually, is the heart. Medically, if the heart is sound, the health is sound, the body is sound. Spiritually, the Prophet ﷺ said, إِذَا صَلُحَتْ صَلُحَ الْجَسَدُ كُلُّ If the heart is nourished, then the entire body will obey Allah. وَإِذَا فَسَدَتْ فَسَدَ الْجَسَدُ كُلُّ If the heart is polluted, if the heart is contaminated, if the heart is corrupted, then that entire body is corrupted. أَلَا وَهِيَ الْقَلْبِ And that refers to the heart. Today, if we look at our hearts, unfortunately, the malice and the evil that our hearts harbor, amongst those people that were denied and are denied forgiveness and pardon on this auspicious night, one is a person who carries malice and jealousy and antagonism in his heart. I came across a brilliant quotation of Abdullah ibn Abbas radiallahu anhu, which gives us a reflection of how clean his heart was. Someone verbally abused him. So he told that person, إِنَّكَ لَتَشْتِمُنِي وَإِنَّ فِيَّ ثَلَاثُ خِصَالٍ Oh my brother, you choose to verbally abuse me when I enjoy three exclusive privileges. Number one, إِنِّي لَآتِي عَلَىٰ آيَةٍ مِّن كِتَابِ اللَّهِ فَلَوَدِدْتُ أَنَّ جَمِيعَ النَّاسِ يَعْلَمُونَ مَا أَعْلَمُ Sometimes I'm studying the Quran and I come on a verse and then I start contemplating on the depth of this verse. And then Allah opens up volumes of knowledge to me from this verse. And Allah be my witness, I desire that the entire world understands this verse as I understood it. I enjoy such spirituality from that verse that I wish the entire world could understand the implications of this verse. I ask you, my brother, you struck a deal. Have you ever desired that somebody else can strike that same deal? No, no, on the reverse, you say it must never happen. Someone says how it happened, no, no, the company closed down. I was the last person, the company closed down. I got upgraded to business class, now no more. No more, there's enough place in the economy class. Only me. وَإِذَا مَسَّهُ الْخَيْرُ مَنُوعًا When good comes his way, he becomes possessive. Nobody else must get a share. So he says, when I arrive at a verse, I wish the entire world understands it. Number two, إِنِّي لَأَسْمَعُ بِالْحَاكِمِ مِنْ حُكَّامِ الْمُسْلِمِينَ يَعْدِلُ فِي حُكْمِهِ At times I hear of one Muslim judge in a particular land and I am told that he governs with justice. Allah be my witness, I become ecstatic, I become elated. And make no mistake, I don't have any vested interest. Perhaps I'll never meet him nor see him, but just that I know there is a judge who is ruling with justice and is an asset to the Muslim ummah, I rejoice over it. It brings joy to me to know that some Muslims are getting good in some part of the world. وَإِنِّي لَأَسْمَعُ بِالْغَيْثِ قَدْ أَصَابَ الْبَلَدَ مِنْ بِلَادِ الْمُسْلِمِينَ And at times I am informed that beneficial rain comes to a Muslim community. I have no relatives there, nor do I have animals grazing in that land, but simply that I know beneficial rain has benefited a Muslim community, wallah, I rejoice over it. So that was the cleanliness of the heart of Sahaba. This is how they desired good for others. One person was sitting by the name of Hassan, a woman came begging. So he looked at this woman, he told his slave that give her 400 dirhams. He found her to be fairly attractive, he said give her 400 dirhams. So the slave said, Sa'ilatun tas'aluka dirhaman, this is a poor woman, she's asking you with a dirham, she'll be happy with one or two, why do you give her four? He said, I looked at this woman and I found that Allah has given her beauty. I did not want her desperation must compel her to immorality. I did not want her desperation must compel her to immorality. She has beauty, least she gets that desperate that she has to sell herself so that she can make some money. I decided, let me enrich her, empower her, perhaps someone will marry her. Look at how clean their hearts were. What was their vision? Now today, if we sit and we analyze this very heart, as I said, it's the crucial organ of our body. And let us monitor our hearts, not medically. Medically, we know doctors are monitoring his heartbeat. But spiritually, let us monitor our hearts. And if we have to dissect our body and do some soul searching, I'm afraid you will find the aspirations of an average Muslim in par with that of a non-Muslim, if not worse. The aspirations and vision that is in my heart and in the heart of a non-Muslim, he denies Qiyamah, so his attitude to life is different. He's going to indulge in life. He's going to make the absolute of it because he doesn't believe in anything beyond. But he who believes in a life that is to come, his attitude towards life has to be different. Allah says, يَعْلَمُونَ ظَاهِرًا مِنَ الْحَيَاةِ الدُّنْيَا وَهُمْ عَنِ الْآخِرَةِ هُمْ غَافِلُونَ. That they have excelled in this world and they have mastered this world while they remain heedless and oblivious of the life of Akhirat. The quotation of Hassan Basri in Ibn Kathir is very unique in this regard. He says under the commentary of this ayah, listen to this attentively, brothers. He says, وَاللَّهِ لَبَلَغَ مِنْ أَحَدِهِمْ بِدُنْيَاهُ أَنْ يُقَلِّبَ الدِّرْهَمَ عَلَىٰ ظَفْرِهِ فَيُخْبِرُكَ بِوَزْنِهِ وَمَا يُحْسِنُ أَنْ يُصَلِّي. That where Allah says people will materially prosper, yet they will be heedless about Akhirat, a time will come that a man will master his world to such an extent, he'll become a super authority. He will look at the coin, the words of Hassan Basri, he will flip the coin in the air, and without weighing that coin, he will tell you the exact, the weight of that coin. Without physically weighing the coin, he'll tell you the weight of that coin. In today's time, a man will look at a note and he'll tell you it's counterfeit. He will look at a customer and he says, that's a potential buyer. Few times that I had to buy a car, looked at the car, I said, this is an ideal car. Took it to my friend, Morana, this is a code 3, this was in an accident. From a distance, he will tell you. Hassan Basri says he'll master his world. He will know how to develop everything. وَمَا يُحْسِنُ أَن يُصَلِّ. But don't even ask him how to read Surah Fatiha. He won't know that also. What did Hassan Basri say? He will ideally prosper on both fronts. Ideally establish your world and prosper spiritually. But the same reality which we cannot deny, we've prospered on one note. Rather spiritual than material if you have to choose between the two. Ideally go on both numbers and develop your world and explore. And at the same time, you know, complement it with spirituality. And Abdullah ibn Abbas radiallahu anhu commentating on this ayat, he said, يَعْرِفُونَ عِمْرَانَ الدُّنْيَا وَهُمْ فِي أَمْرِ الدِّينِ جُهَّال. They will understand the theory of developing a site, developing a land, you know, developing, putting up clusters, putting up homes. That they will be super authorities on. وَهُمْ فِي أَمْرِ الدِّينِ جُهَّال. But in the matters of deen, they will be the most ignorant people that the history has ever seen. Now let's look at this and do some soul searching. Allah says, بَلِ الدَّارَكَ عِلْمُهُمْ لِرَا. That their knowledge has failed them in the matters of Akhirah. Their knowledge has failed them. أَيْ عَجَزَ عَنْ مَعْرِفَةِ حَقِّهَا بَلْ هُمْ فِي شَكٍ مِّنْهَا أَيْ شَكُونَ فِي وُجُودِهَا. Not only fail them, they are still doubting whether Qiyamah exists or not. They are still doubting whether Qiyamah exists or not. So today I want that we sit here and do some soul searching on our heart. And we speak about another form of development and that spiritual development. It was the night of 15th of Shaban. Aisha radiallahu anha says, my Nabi jumped into bed as was his usual practice. And when I had fallen off to sleep, or he perceived that I had fallen off to sleep, he excused himself from the bed and he left the room. As a woman or as a human, there was a twinge of suspicion that gripped my heart. Where is my Nabi going? And the suspicion obviously was, is he going to visit another wife? It was the Nabi of Allah, so there could not be any suspicion of anything haram. So it is common, well, Islam discourages suspicion, but from time to time it does feature in the relation. Unfortunately, when our woman or our wives have suspicion amongst us and she advances towards the phone, the sad reality is the suspicion becomes a reality. Whatever she is doubting about us becomes a reality. If I tell you, brothers, wallah, every time I speak, I have told you this and I will continue speaking. Averagely, I receive 3 social calls a day. Out of the 3, 2 are marital and both are regarding infidelity. Yesterday there was a sister that phoned again about the same problem of this, SMSing. My husband is receiving, and now it's gone to a degree that is worse, and let's mix it. There is a colleague of mine who graduated and has done some extensive research on this year. Last week we were gone for a program, and then we went for, they took us on a hunting trip at night. So 1 o'clock in the morning after we came back in the game farm, he says, Maulana, let me just show you how this thing operates. At this time, if I tell you how many people are chatting, I couldn't comprehend the extent of this fitna. What did the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam say? Aral fitan taqa'u khilala buyutikum kawaq'il matar. Oh my sahaba, I can literally see trials descending. It is landing on your rooftops like how rain comes down. I can see fitnas coming, one after the other in succession. There was another sister that phoned last week. You know, I share this, and I tell them I share it so that it conscientizes me, you, and one and all. What's the complaint of the sister? Maulana, my husband wants to employ a young girl who is very beautiful and very attractive. And we don't need this employment. And when I told her that, I told him, it's, you know, you are vulnerable, the chances are you are prone to commit a sin. No, it's purely from a marketing strategy. It's purely from a marketing perspective. That, you know, enhance the sales and the sales lady and you'll boost up. If I could only transmit the pain of that sister, is there any dua that I can read that this woman will decline the offer? I said, I wish I knew that dua, my sister. But I just cannot convince my husband. I don't want to doubt him. But knowing him very well, why does he deliberately go and put himself into such a situation? Nonetheless, Aisha radiallahu anha said, the suspicion gripped my heart. It gripped my heart. And that is why it is important. Islam believes that we should conduct ourselves with dignity, that we don't leave room for people to harbor ill feelings against us. One of the reasons why the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said that a'linun nikah, announce your marriages, is so that tomorrow when you walk with that girl in society, officially you are wedded to her. Give no person a reason to sit and accuse you or to tarnish you or to implicate you or insult you. Officially you were wedded in the masjid, so everybody is acquainted. Anyway, Aisha radiallahu anha said, I was left ashamed. I was left embarrassed. That this is what crossed my heart. Perhaps he's going to visit one of his other wives. To my utter surprise, I found him standing in the graveyard making dua for the Muslim Ummah. And in one riwayat it comes, I went out, I started looking up and down, I paced around, and when I returned, I found he was in salah in the room. And then he was making such a lengthy sajda, that for a moment I thought he had passed away. For a moment I thought it. Now that would happen to our wife, they'll phone when we don't come back from shop. We'll come back so late, what happened? His phone is just ringing. There's no reply. The office phones are just ringing. He hasn't yet come back. What has happened? Unfortunately, that thought will only cross us when he's there in the shop. That is when he comes back so late. Aisha radiallahu anha said, there was a panic in my heart. I then gently put my hand on his foot and I felt warmth and there was movement. So I could sigh with relief that he was alive and he was well. But so lengthy was his sajda. When he completed his salah, he then jumped into the bed with me again. And I was pulsating. So he said, Aisha, what's the matter? So again, this is again the beauty of Islam. Be honest in your relation. You picked up, my sister, you picked up your husband's phone. And then he asked you, he said, no, I needed to make a call. No, don't say you needed to make a call. Tell him why you picked it up. I want to see who you've been SMSing. I want to see your phone. Live open, live transparent. Don't doubt, but live transparent. Live transparent. I've got nothing to hide. You've got nothing to hide. So she said, oh, Nabi Allah, let me be honest. When you left this room, something crossed my mind. And I just felt that you were going to visit another wife on my night. So Nabi alayhi salam first told her, oh Aisha, do you think Allah's Nabi will ever betray you? Do you think Allah will deal with you unjustly? And then Nabi alayhi salam took his blessed hand and calmly rubbed it over her knees and said, I pity your body. You exerted it so much unnecessarily. I pity, look at the calmness of Nabi sallallahu alayhi wasallam, how he conducted himself. There was that incident when he became angry with his spouses. And then he left them and he said, I'm going for a month. The hadith is very long. Allah speaks about it in the Quran as well. And then he returned after 29 days. Aisha radiallahu anha, like any other woman, she, maybe if we might use the word provoke, or maybe that's a too strong a word, she challenged Nabi sallallahu alayhi wasallam. She challenged. She said, O Nabi of Allah, you were saying you will do without us for a month and you're back. You said you'll go away for 30 days and you're back after 29. Now put yourself in that situation, you walk out and you tell your wife, I'm not coming for 1 week, and then you come back after 2 days and then she's not, so what happened, you couldn't do without me. How would you react? Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, I'm going for 30 days and he was back in 29. So Aisha radiallahu anha challenged, so what happened to the 30 days? Nabi alayhi sallam said, Aisha, I did not say 30 days, I said a month, and some months consist of 29 days. What vision, what calmness, what balance, what maturity? Now that is what I want to speak about. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam went to the grave. The visiting of the grave was not an exclusive feature of 15 Sha'ban. Aisha radiallahu anha says, every week when he visited me, he visited the graveyard. Scholars deduce from this that the bare minimum is that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam visited the graveyard weekly, if not more. But this is definite that he visited the grave once a week. When he entered the grave, what are the etiquettes? What is the dua? Assalamu alaikum. He first would greet. And what would he say? Diyara qawmin. To the inhabitants of this land. To the occupants of this grave. Antum salafuna wa nahnu bil athar. You've arrived before us. We will be joining you shortly. Yaghfiru Allahu lana wa lakum. May Allah forgive you and us collectively. Nabi alayhi salatu wa salam would sit by the grave and make dua for his ummah, as I mentioned, often. And what did he tell the sahaba? Kuntu qad nahitukum an ziyarati al-qubur fazuruha. Oh my sahaba, initially I had prohibited you from visiting the graveyard. But now I am telling you, visit it in abundance. Visit it in not as a ritual. But he's referred to death as the destroyer of all desires. He's referred to death. If there's anything that can put an end to your lust, to your ego, to your evil, it is death and death alone. So let me quote before you a few ahadith regarding the reality of the grave. So that when we stand at the side of the grave, whether we visit the deceased today or at any other day, we reflect and introspect. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, when a person passes away, you know, the poet says it so beautifully, وَأَلْبَسُونِ ثِيَابًا لَا كِمَامَ لَهَا وَصَلُّوا صَلَاةً لَا رُكُوعَ لَهَا وَلَا سُجُودَ لَعَلَّ اللَّهَ يَرْحَمُنِي. That when my soul has left my body, the first thing that happens is my saliva becomes bitter. Then I am covered in a cloth without sleeves, but I have no choice in the matter. They take me forward and a salah is performed on me which has no ruku or sajda. Hopefully my Lord accepts the intercession. I am then taken to the grave. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, the deceased is saying, قَدِّمُونِ, move with me quickly, hasten with me. He is then lowered into the grave. He is lowered into the grave. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said in the riwayat of Abu Dawud, إِنَّهُ لَيَسْمَعُ خَفْقَ نِعَالِهِمْ إِذَا وَلَّوْ مُدْبِرِينَ. O my sahaba, make no mistake, as you're leaving, he's listening to what you're talking. Nay, he can listen to your footsteps as well. As you have left, تُعَادُ رُوحُهُ إِلَى جَسَدِهِ. Nabi alayhi salam says, the first thing that happens is his soul is returned to his body. His soul is returned to his body. You have left, he's heard the shuffle around, and they have left. تُعَادُ رُوحُهُ إِلَى جَسَدِهِ. His soul returns to his body. Uthman ibn Affan radiallahu anhu says, whenever the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam completed from any burial, he stood at the grave. And then he would say, استغفروا لأخيكم فإنه الآن يسأل واسألوا له التثبيت. Listen, all of you stay here at the grave. Don't leave. You've completed the burial, but stay here. Why? Ask Allah to forgive your brother. For verily, he is going to be subjected to the most critical moment in his entire life. And ask Allah to keep him firm. The most frightening sight is to reveal and to unveil before him. I have received numerous calls where a person, Morana, make dua, my wife is going into the labor room now. Make dua, they've taken my father into theater. Make dua, the interview is at 9 o'clock. Make dua, the court proceedings start at 10 o'clock. Nabi alayhi salam says, make dua at this time for him. لَقِّنُوا مَوْتَاكُمْ بِلَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهِ. Encourage the deceased with the articulation of the kalima la ilaha illallah. Imam Abu Hanifa is of the opinion that read it to the dying man. Imam Shafi rahmatullahi says, no, read it to the dead man. Read it to the dead man when he is lowered into the grave. Stand by his grave and read La ilaha illallah in abundance. Why? فَإِنَّهُ الْآنَ يُسْأَلْ. Now he will be tested. So what did Nabi alayhi salam say? أَتَاهُ مَلَكَان. Two angels come. Aswadan, dark skin. Azraqan, furious eyes. Now this is what the Quran says. Super authorities in developing this world, but they've never dared develop in their grave. When Nabi alayhi salam went for Mi'raj, and he met Sayyidina Ibrahim alayhi salam. Ibrahim alayhi salam told him that, O Muhammad, أَقْرِ أُمَّتَكَ مِنِّ السَّلَامِ. Convey your ummah my choicest salams. And tell them, for the record, Jannat is a barren land. Every man's Jannat is what he develops out of it. Every man's Jannat is what he develops out of it. So by its nature, it's a barren land. It would be very foolish for a man to say, no, I want to stay in Houghton. The houses are very big here. No, my friend, you pay for a big house, then you own a big house. But the houses by itself, it's nothing. It was a barren land, you develop it. The cluster you put up, the house you live in. لا دار للمرء بعد الموت يسكنها إلا التي قبل الموت كان يبنيها فإن بناها بخير طاب مسكنه وإن بناها بشر خاب بانيها. There's no house in which you will dwell after your death but the one that you built while you were alive. If you built it well, good luck to the accommodation. If you didn't build it, tough luck to you. ترجو البقاء بدار. What does the poet say? أتبني بناء الخالدين وإنما مقامك فيها لو عقلت قليل. You build a dwelling of eternity wherein you are to live for few days. Your life is so short, in fact the shade of a tree would have sufficed. لقد كان في ظل العراق كفاية لمن كان فيها يعتريه رحيل. So anyway, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says these two angels appear to him in the grave. Then he goes on to describe them. أصواتهما كالرعد القاصف وأبصارهما كالبرق الخاطف. Their sight is like lightning. Their voice is like thunder. Then they have a lash in their hand. They have a whip in their hand. لو اجتمع عليه أهل مينا لم يطيقوا رفعها. If all the people of Mina unite their talent and they try and collectively lift it up, they won't able to lift it. But those angels will have total control over it. لو ضرباك بها ضربا. If they touch you with it once, you'll be reduced to ashes. Umar radiallahu anhu said, I have one question to ask. أترد إلينا عقولنا. Will our logic and sanity be restored? Will we visualize? Will we be focused? Nabi alayhi salam says, yes. كهيئتكم اليوم. Just as I'm talking and you listening, you will be intact. Every organ will be intact. One riwayat of Ibn Majah, Jabir radiallahu anhu says, مثلت الشمس عند غروبها. As he will enter into the grave and the soil will be covered. And the angel will announce, يَبْنَ آدَمْ خَرَجْتَ مِنَ التُّرَابِ وَعُدْتَ إِلَى التُّرَابِ خَرَجْتَ بِلَا ذَنْبٍ وَعُدْتَ وَكُلُّكَ ذُنُوبُ. You started from here, you return here. The only thing is you started sinless and you return full of sins. The riwayat of Ibn Majah, it will appear to this deceased as if the sun is setting. As he will enter into the grave and the sand will cover him and the relatives will leave, the vision that he will get is مُثِّلَتِ الشَّمْسُ عِنْدَ غُرُوبِهَا. That it's just sunset. It's just touching the western horizon. He'll get up according to one riwayat, يَمْسَحُ عَيْنَيْ. Gently rubbing his eyes. Where am I? And one riwayat of Abu Dawud, يُجِلِسَانِهِ. The angels will tap him. Get up, my friend, get up. We got serious work with you. We need to talk to you. He will get up. These frightening angels before him, in the loneliness of his grave, in the darkness of his grave, how can you forget this grave, my brother? Aisha radiallahu anha said, ما رأيت رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم صلى صلاة إلا تعوذ من عذاب القبر. I cannot recall the Nabi of Allah performing any salah after which he did not ask Allah protection from the punishment of the grave. I ask you if you have ever made that dua to Allah. من ربك, who is your Lord? ربي الله. He will answer. If he answers, Allah make us amongst those people. My Lord is Allah. The riwayat of Musnad Ahmad, وَهَلْ رَأَيْتَ اللَّهِ. Have you seen Allah? لَا يَنْبَغِي لِأَحَدٍ أَنْ يَرَى اللَّهِ. No, I haven't seen Allah and it's not possible to see Allah. Second question, مَا دِينُكْ. What is your faith? What is your faith? Not what car you drive. مَا دِينُكْ. What is your faith? What is your religion? دِينِي الْإِسْلَامِ. My religion is Islam. مَنْ هَذَا الرَّجُلُ الَّذِي بُعِثَ فِيكُمْ. What's your take on this man that came as a prophet? هو رسول الله. He is the Prophet of Allah. وما يدريك. What's your proof that he is the Prophet of Allah? قَرَأْتُ كِتَابَ اللَّهِ فَآمَنْتُ بِهِ. I read the book of Allah and I am convinced that he is the Nabi of Allah. Are you convinced? Yes. فَيُفْتَحُ لَهُ فُرَجَةٌ قِبَلَ النَّارِ. A door of hell will be opened up for him. He will then see the rage of Jahannam. تَكَادُ تَمَيَّزُ مِنَ الْغَيْرِ. تَكَادُ تَمَيَّزُ مِنَ الْغَيْرِ. Allah says, it is as if the fire wants to burst with fury. It is as if the fire wants to burst with fury. لَهُمْ فِيهَا زَفِيرِ. Zafir refers to the brain of a donkey. إِنَّ الَّذِينَ سَبَقَتْ لَهُمْ مِنَّ الْحُسْنَى أُولَٰئِكَ عَنْهَا مُبَعْدُونَ. كلما ألقي فيها فوج سألهم خزنتها ألم يأتيكم نذير. He will see hell. He'll see the torment. He'll see the pain. He'll see the agony. It will be then told to him, we are only showing you this so that you can understand the privilege Allah has afforded you. You've been saved from this. Move on. انظر إلى ما وقاك الله منه. انظر إلى ما وقاك الله منه. You've been saved from this so that you can appreciate your accommodation even more. فَيُفْتَحُ لَهُ فُرْجَةٌ قِبَلَ الْجَنَّةِ. Then the door of Jannah will be open. فَيَأْتِيهِ مِنْ رَوْحِهَا وَطِيبِهَا. He'll get the fragrance. What they talk of, aromatherapy nowadays. Aromatherapy. Nabi alayhi salam said, إِذَا اسْتَعْتَرَتِ الْمَرْأَةِ. When a woman applies deodorants, and then she leaves her house, what strong smelling fragrances. Then the Prophet of Allah has referred to her in the words of an adulteress. She who goes out to attract men by virtue of her fragrance, by virtue of her deodorants, and then she passes by a group of people. Obviously, the scent is going to attract people towards her. The Prophet ﷺ has used the stern words of immoral and adulterous upon her. Then Allah will announce, Sadaqa Abdi, my servant has spoken the truth. فَفْتَحُوا لَهُ بَابًا إِلَى الْجَنَّةِ. Open the door of Jannah. وَفْرُشُوا لَهُ إِلَى الْجَنَّةِ. Spread out the carpet of Jannah. And then he will get the fragrance of Jannah. He will get so happy, he'll ask the Malaika, دَعُونِي حَتَّى أُبَشِّرَ أَهْلِي. Give me a chance, please. I want to go and rejoice and tell my mother and my family that I've made it. So they'll tell him, relax. أُسْكُنْ نَمْكَ نَوْمَةِ الْعَرُوسِ. Sleep like the bride sleeps on the first night. Nobody is going to arrest you. You go to sleep and enjoy it. That is, if Allah makes us amongst those fortunate people. But on the reverse, Allah forbid, on the occasion when there was a solar eclipse in Madinah Munawwara, and then the Prophet ﷺ delivered a sermon, and Asma bint Abi Bakr radiallahu anha said, there is a salah that is to be performed. A few years ago while I was studying, and there was a solar eclipse, we had the good opportunity of performing the salah. It is referred to as Salatul Kusuf, that is the salah of a solar eclipse. And there is a khusuf that refers to the lunar eclipse. There is a salah that is offered for both the solar and the lunar eclipse. So anyway, there was a solar eclipse in Medina, and this coincided with the death of the son of Nabi alayhi salam. So many people had the misconception that it was as a mark of mourning the demise of a great person. That is why the sun had also eclipsed. But the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam did not latch on to this credit when this wasn't the reality. I mean, we like to latch on to anything. We like to latch on to something. You say, why must I tell him? If he believes, then let him believe, man. If he believes, I'm the owner. Good luck to his beliefs. Maybe one day Allah will make me. Who knows? Asma radiallahu anha says, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam delivered a talk. Then he got emotional in the talk and he said, وَلَقَدْ أُوحِيَ إِلَيَّ أَنَّكُمْ تُفْتَنُونَ فِي قُبُورِكُمْ قَرِيبًا مِّن فِتْنَةِ الْمَسِيحِ الدَّجَّالِ. I have just been informed now through revelation that when you'll be lowered into your grave, the test will be so challenging. I equate it to the fitna of Dajjal. I have been informed that when you'll be lowered into your grave, you'll be subjected to such difficulties that it will be like the fitna of Dajjal. Now let me digress and make you understand what is Dajjal, then you can appreciate what is the grave. The riwayat of Abu Umama Bahili radiallahu anhu in Hakim, it appears. He says, Khatabana Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam khutbah. The Prophet of Allah delivered a sermon. Fakana aktharu khutbatihi dhikru Dajjal. The greater portion of his talk was focused on the fitna of Dajjal. What did he say? Inna Allah ta'ala lam yab'ath nabiyan illa hadhara ummatahu ad-Dajjal. Every Nabi that came warned and cautioned his nation against the fitna of Dajjal. وَإِنِّي آخِرُ الْأَنْبِيَا وَأَنْتُمْ آخِرُ الْأُمَمِ I'm the last prophet, you're the last nation. وَهُوَ خَارِجٌ فِيكُمْ لَا مَحَالَ Inevitably, Dajjal will make his appearance. فَإِنْ يَخْرُجْ وَأَنَا فِيكُمْ فَأَنَا حَجِيجُهُ If he makes his presence, if he makes his appearance in my presence, I will defend the entire ummah. But the likelihood is his appearance will be after my demise. And should that be the case, every man will have to defend him on the strength of his own faith. The likelihood is his appearance is after my demise. And if he comes after my demise, each man on the strength of his own iman will have to defend and combat. Then he said he'll make his appearance from a place between Iraq and Sham. Atha yameen and atha shimala. He'll move in the east and the west and he'll cause corruption on this earth. Now what I'm saying is the Prophet of Allah said that your testing in the grave will be similar to the testing of Dajjal. There's one difference, Dajjal, there is a collective ummah that will combat him. In the grave you are alone, my brother. Then he paused and he said, Ya ibadallah fathbutu. O friends of Allah, I beg you persevere and remain firm. He will start off his deviation by saying, Inni nabiyukum. I am your prophet. وَلَا نَبِيَّ بَعْدِي And let me remind you, there is no prophet after me. He will start off his deviation by saying, I am your prophet. The riwayat of Muslim Sharif, Nabi alayhi salam said, مَثَلِي وَمَثَلُ الْأَنْبِيَاءِ مِنْ قَبْلِي كَمَثَلِ رَجُلٍ بَنَى بَيْتًا My example and those prophets that preceded me is like a house that was constructed. And it was completed with the exception of one brick in one corner. فَجَعَلَ النَّاسُ يَتُوفُونَ بِهِ وَيَعْجَبُونَ People came, they admired this house. They said, what a beautiful building. If only the final brick could be added to complete this house of prophethood. فَأَنَا اللَّبِنَا I am the final brick that completes and concludes the house of prophethood. لَا نَبِيَّ بَعْدِي There is no prophet after me. So that's his first claim. But he will not end there. He'll progress in his claim. He will then say, أَنَا رَبَّكُمْ I am your Lord. And make no mistake, لَن تَرَوْ رَبَّكُمْ حَتَّى تَمُوتُ You will not see your Lord till you die. Then وَإِنَّ مِنْ فِتْنَتِهِ فَمَنْ لَقِيَهُ مِنْكُمْ فَمَنْ لَقِيَهُ مِنْكُمْ فَلْيَتْفُلْ عَلَىٰ وَجْهِهِ If any one of you sees him, then advance towards him and spit on his face. وَلْيَقْرَ عَلَيْهِ فَوَاتِحَ سُورَةَ الْكَهْفِ And read the opening verses of Surah Kahf and blow on him. الْحَمْدُ لِلَّهِ الَّذِي أَنزَلَ عَلَىٰ عَبْدِهِ الْكِتَابَ وَلَمْ يَجْعَلْ لَهُ عِوَجًا قَيِّمًا لِيُنذِرَ بَأْسًا شَدِيدًا مِنْ لَدُنْهُ ويبشر المؤمنين الذين يعملون الصالحات أن لهم أجرا حسنا ماكثين فيه أبدا Read the opening verses. Nabi alayhi salam said, let me tell you what are his challenges. He will be given access to a human. يُسَلَّتُ عَلَى نَفْسٍ مِّن بَنِي آدَمْ He'll come to that man. He'll tell that person, do you believe that I am your deity? That person will refute and say, no, I don't believe. In fact, you are the evil Dajjal. He will say, okay, I will cause your death and revive you. He'll then split this man in half. He'll split this man in half and then revive him. He'll tell this man, are you now convinced that I am your deity? This person, according to one riwayat, will be a very young, pious boy. Shabun mumtali'un imana. Nabi alayhi salam described this boy by saying, he will be a youth in the prime of his life, but he will be brimming with iman. He will be, so he'll take Dajjal head on. He'll challenge him head on. He'll engage him head on. He will say, I am only more convinced that you are Dajjal now. The proof of that is, if you are the deity, then repeat what you did. He will try for the second time, but he'll fail. But the masses will still flock towards him. People will fall for one thing. That's the first thing. Nabi alayhi salam says, وَإِنَّ مِنْ فِتْنَتِهِ Amongst his fitnas is, مَعَهُ نَارٌ وَنَهْرُدْ He will have hell on his right and paradise on his left. Understand, his paradise is the hell of Allah, his hell is the paradise of Allah. If you have to fall, fall in his hell and not in his paradise. فَمَنِ ابْتُلِيَ بِنَارِهِ If you fall in his hell, make dua to Allah, he'll make it peaceful for you as he made it for Ibrahim. وَإِنَّ مِنْ فِتْنَتِهِ Understand, Nabi alayhi salam said, your grave will be like the fitna of Dajjal. Then he says, amongst the trials of Dajjal is, he will pass by a group of people. He will invite them to believe on him. فَيُؤْمِنُونَ بِهِ They'll accept him. He'll point to the sky, it will shower rain. He'll point to the earth, it will give off vegetation. He'll point to the cows, it will give off milk. In other words, accepting his message will be taken on apparent prosperity. Apparent. Can you imagine when accepting his message will bring instant prosperity, apparently, how challenging it will be. Today a man cannot resist the challenge or the temptation of interest, when it's not immediate, it's long term, it's supposed, it's alleged, perhaps, maybe, who knows, but it's long term and he gets so tempted. Here you'll accept him and the sky will give rain, you'll accept him and the earth will give vegetation. And that's not all. The consequences will be reversed for those who deny him. He'll pass by a next group, they'll say, you are Dajjal. He'll point to the sky, it will be drought. He'll point to the earth, that will be the end of vegetation. He'll point to the cattle, they will start dying. He'll say, you see those that accepted me prosperity. Can you imagine how trying this moment is? Sahaba said, وَمَا لُبْثُهُ عَلَى الْأَرْضِ. How long will he stay? 40 يَوْمَا, 40 days. But the first day will be equivalent to a year. Look at the vision of Sahaba, that day that will be equivalent to a year. Do we perform 5 salah or salah equivalent to a year? Where is the mind of Sahaba? Where are they thinking? He will tour the world. Nabi alayhi salam said he will come to Medina. مَا مِن بَابٍ مِنْ أَبْوَابِهَا إِلَّا عَلَيْهِ مَلَكٌ مُسَلَّتٌ. But my Allah will send angels at every entry and exit point of Medina that will be guarding the surroundings of Medina, that will be guarding Makkah. They would not allow him and give him access into Makkah and Medina. And in one riwayat it comes regarding the same incident of Dajjal. The Prophet ﷺ told the Sahaba, listen, if I have lacked in my duty of discharging the responsibility upon you, then tell me. They said, O Nabi of Allah, we in one voice say, بَلَّغْتَ رِسَالَةَ رَبِّكَ وَنَسَحْتَ لِأُمَّتِكَ وَقَضَيْتَ الَّذِي كَانَ عَلَيْكَ. We testify, you've adequately discharged your obligation. He said, now listen to what I have to tell you. With regards to the solar eclipse, قَدْ زَعَمَ بَعْضُ النَّاسِ أَنَّ كُسُوفَ هَذِهِ الشَّمْسِ وَخُسُوفَ هَذَا الْقَمْرِ وَزَوَالَ هَذِهِ النُّجُومِ لِمَوْتِ رِجَالٍ عُظَمَاءَ مِنْ أَهْلِ الْأَرْضِ. Some people have this notion that the sun eclipses, or the moon, or there is some change in the galaxy, or there is a falling star, that this is associated to the death of a great person. Let me clear this. The Prophet ﷺ says this is a myth. This is a myth. There is no reality to this here. وَلَكِنَّهَا آيَةٌ مِّنْ آيَاتِ اللَّهِ يَخْتَبِرُ اللَّهُ بِهَا عِبَادًا. But these are signs from Allah by virtue of which He examines His servants. He then said, while I engaged in the salah of the solar eclipse, مُنْذُ قُمْتُ أَنْ أُصَلِّ, and I stood here and I led you in congregation, Allah showed me every fitna that you will face till the day of Qiyamah. So standing here, Allah unveiled everything to me. Allah, you know, sometimes you speak to a doctor, he says, no, you don't have to tell me your history. I've taken out your files. I've got your files, I've got your blood results, I've got your x-rays. I've got everything. I've got everything here, so don't worry, I know your blood group and everything. Nabi alayhi salam said, every fitna that is to come till Qiyamah was opened up before me now. And I found the worst of it to be the fitna of Dajjal. He will come in this world, مَكْتُوبٌ بَيْنَ عَيْنَيْهِ كَافِرٌ. On his forehead will be written infidel. يَقْرَأُهُ كُلُّ مُؤْمِنٍ. Only a true believer will identify it. فَمَنْ صَدَّقَهُ. Whoever will believe in him, it will render all his good actions null and void. Now I can go and discuss this fitna of Dajjal in much more detail. I only want to tie it up. What did the Prophet ﷺ say? وَلَقَدْ أُوحِيَ إِلَيَّ أَنَّكُمْ تُفْتَنُونَ فِي قُبُورِكُمْ قَرِيبًا مِّن فِتْنَةِ الْمَسِيحِ الدَّجَّالِ. I was informed that the test in the grave is going to be like that of the fitna of Dajjal. In one riwayat it comes, Musnad in Ibn Abi Dunya makes mention of this here, that when a person passes away and he enters into the grave, فَتَلَقَّاهُمْ أَرْوَاحَ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ الْمَاضِيَةِ, then all the pious souls that had passed away, they come and receive him. And they want to query from him, what's the happenings in the world? What's the latest on this person? This is according to Hassan Basri, mentioned in Ibn Abi Dunya. So the Malaika, Thabit Banani says, the Malaika then intervene and they say, أُرْفُقُوا بِهِ فَإِنَّهُ قَدْ خَرَجَ مِنْ كَرْبٍ عَظِيمٍ. Listen, take it slowly, the man has just died now. He'll tell you everything. You know, give him time, he'll report. He's come through a very critical moment, a very crucial moment. Anyway, he calms down, then the souls gather by him. And the souls ask him, مَا فَعَلَ فُلَانٌ. So and so in the world, what's the latest? خَيْرًا, Alhamdulillah, he's doing good. Then they ask, مَا فَعَلَ فُلَانٌ, what about so and so? So this person who has just died, the new deceased, so to say, he says, you're asking me, that man has died long before me, I supposed to ask you about him. مَاتَ قَبْلِي أَلَمْ يَأْتِكُمْ. He's died long time, so I don't have any news about him. Someone phones and asks you, by, you know, phoning from Australia, house. I thought he moved to Australia. I thought you were going to give me information. I thought you were going to, he says, no, but he hasn't come to me. So these souls then realize, if the man is no more in the world and he hasn't joined the pious, that means he's gone to hell. That I'm asking you about this particular soul, you're telling me he's died. You're telling me he's died already. But we haven't met him yet. Salaka bihi ila ummihi al-hawiya. That means he has been driven to the evil abode of hell. Ka'b Ahbar says, as he is lowered into the grave, his good actions come and surround him if he has. So salah stands at his feet, fasting stands at his head, sadaqah stands by his hands, and hajj stands and patrols the remaining part of the body. فَتَجِيءُ مَلَائِكَةُ الْعَذَابِ. These angels of torment, they enter into the grave. فَيَأْتُونَ مِنْ قِبَلِ رِجْلَيْهِ. They advance and they attack from the legs. So these angels, there is salah in the form of a handsome person, stands up and says, إِلَيْكُمْ عَنْهُ. Listen, don't try your luck here. You can go try another entry, not from here. فَقَدْ أَطَالَ الْقِيَامَ لِلَّهِ تَعَالَى عَلَيْهِمَا. These legs have stood for hours worshipping Allah. When Urwa ibn Zubair's leg was amputated, then he said, bring my leg here. After his leg was amputated, he took his hand and then gently started stroking it over this amputated leg and he started crying. He said, وَالَّذِي حَمَلَنِي عَلَيْكِ فِي عَتَمَاتِ اللَّيْلِ إِلَى الْمَسَاجِدِ يَعْلَمُ أَنَّنِي مَا مَشَيْتُ بِكِ إِلَى حَرَامٍ قَتُّ. O leg, I want to tell you that Allah who enabled me to put my weight on you and walk, He knows never have I taken one step putting my weight on you towards anything haram. He gently took his hand and rubbed it over his leg very passionately and he cried. And he said, that Allah who enabled me to put my weight on you and walk, I've never walked towards something haram. When Amr ibn Jamuh was injured and his children were going in battle and they said, Dad, you are injured, you are exempted. So he came to the Prophet of Allah and said, Inna baniya ha'ula'i yamna'unani ujahida ma'ak. Wa inni uhibbu an ata'a biharajati hadhihi fil jannah. O Nabi of Allah, my children say that I must not participate because my foot is lame. But I want to walk with a lame foot. And I want to die with a lame foot. And I want to march in Jannah with my lame foot. I want to march with my lame foot in Jannah. So Salah will tell these angels, you don't come close to him. You know this, don't talk to me, talk to my lawyer. Talk to my lawyer. Talk to my auditors. I'll hand you over to my legal team. These angels will defend him. You talk to me, you don't go to him. Talk to me. What's your problem? I am his Salah. So anyway, they'll try their luck somewhere else. You know, sometimes you want to make a free entry somewhere, you try one door, they change, you try somewhere else. So anyway, they'll come to the head. His fasting will speak. قَدْ أَطَالَ ظَمْأَهُ لِلَّهِ تَعَالَى. This man patiently persevered, thirst for the pleasure of Allah. What was the dua the Prophet ﷺ told us after breaking fast? ذَهَبَ الظَّمَأُ وَبَتَلَّتِ الْعُرُوقُ وَثَبَتَ الْأَجْرُ. The thirst is gone, the veins are quenched, the reward is recorded. What were his words? So beautiful. The day is over. Those that fasted, their day is over. Those that did not fast, their day is over. For those that fasted, the thirst is also gone. The body is quenched. The stomach is saturated and the reward is recorded. ذَهَبَ الظَّمَأُ وَبَتَلَّتِ الْعُرُوقُ وَثَبَتَ الْأَجْرُ إِنْشَاءَ اللَّهِ. Then they will advance from the body. So Hajj will speak. قَدْ أَتْعَبَ نَفْسَهُ وَحَجَّ وَجَاهَدَ لِلَّهِ. This man exerted this body in Hajj. Then they will try and come towards his hands. And what will happen? Sadaqah will speak. What a great action. What a great action. Abdullah ibn Mas'ud has made mention. I came across it in the writings of Ibn Rajab Hanbali. That in the previous nations, عَبَدَ اللَّهَ رَجُلٌ سَبِعِينَ سَنَى. A person worshipped Allah for 70 years. ثُمَّ أَصَابَ فَاحِشَةً. Then he committed an act of immorality. Because of which, zina or something else, but an act of immorality, Allah destroyed all his good actions. ثُمَّ أَصَابَتْهُ زَمَانَةٌ. After that he became sick and paralyzed as a result of his sin or whatever. But he became sick and he became paralyzed. One day he seen one man distributing some food to the poor. So he went to this man and he said, listen, I am disabled. Can you give me some bread and I will also give out to the poor. So he took فَأَخَذَ رَغِيفًا فَتَصَدَّقَ عَلَى مِسْكِينَ. He took a bread and he gave it to a poor person. Allah accepted and appreciated and acknowledged the charity to such an extent. Allah pardoned his son and restored the worship of 70 years. So when the angels will come and attack him from his hands, they will say, The sadaqah that will take the form of a handsome person will say, "Kam min sadaqatin kharajat min hatayn al-yadayn." Do you know how much charity has been given by these hands? You will not come close. In the end, these angels will have to return. As I mentioned, the condition of Umar, and this is intellect. The Prophet ﷺ spoke to Umar, and he mentioned to him about the grave. It comes in Hayatul Sahaba. So then Sayyidina Umar asked few questions. And then he said, "Oh Nabi of Allah, hopefully I will answer these angels." And then he stood up and he started walking. And then the Prophet ﷺ said, "Come ya Umar." Jibreel descended. And Jibreel told me now, that this is a privilege afforded to you. That when the angels will descend to you in the grave, and they will approach you, before they'll start, you'll start. You'll tell them, "Who's your Lord? My Lord is Allah. Who's your Prophet? My Prophet is Muhammad. What is your faith? My faith is Islam." Those angels will say, "La nadri ursilna ilayka am anta ursilta ilayna." I don't know, has Allah sent us to question you, or has Allah sent you to question us? Really, my brother, that is intellect. What did my Nabi say? Al-kayyis. Now go and study Arabic grammar. The most intellectual human. The most intellectual human. That is why someone asked Imam Shafi, that if a person says that when I die, my wealth must be given to the most intelligent man. That's his bequest. That's his wasiyat. That I leave behind my estate for the most intelligent man. Who should the wealth be given to? He said the wealth should be given to the most pious because he's intelligent. If a person makes this wasiyat on his dying bed, that my wealth be given to the most intellectual human. The Prophet ﷺ said, intelligence has been condensed in preparing for death. Intelligence has been condensed in preparing. Al-kayyis man dana nafsahu wa amila lima ba'da al-maut. Now how do we go about? What did Sayyidina Abdullah ibn Abbas radiallahu anhu say? He said, "Iqra tabarak alladhi biyadihi al-mulk. Learn surah tabarak. وَعَلِّمْهَا أَهْلَكَ وَوَلَدَكَ وَجِيرَانَكَ." For Allah's sake, teach it to your wife. Teach it to your children. Nay, teach it to your siblings. In fact, teach it to your neighbors. وَجِيرَانَكَ. Go and teach it to your... We see today people are, you know, on a particular mission, and they're promoting something, and they're going from person to person. You know, going from this one here, promoting this theory. They say this, people were flying. So this youngster was in the buzz of, you know what, you must use contraceptive measures, and we must curtail and curb down, you know, the population crisis. So he came to one pious person. He said, "What do you believe about birth control?" He said, "How old are you, my friend?" He said, "I'm 20 years. He said, "I wish they started it 20 years ago. At least we wouldn't have it. You were here. I wish they started it 20 years ago. Anyway, what I'm saying is, a person is moving from person to person. You see these people promoting, selling this article and that. Abdullah ibn Abbas said, "Go and teach Tabarak to the whole world." فَإِنَّهَا الْمُنَجِّيَةِ فَإِنَّهَا الْمُنَجِّيَةِ تُجَادِلُ وَتُخَاسِمُ عِنْدَ اللَّهِ لِقَارِئَةِ. It will stand in the grave and argue your case before Allah. And trust me, it won't leave you till Allah doesn't forgive you. It will not leave you till Allah doesn't forgive you. One riwayat of Tirmidhi, one sahabi says, "I pitched a tent and I wasn't even conscious of it. فَإِذَا أَنَا بِإِنسَانٍ يَقْرَأْ سُورَةَ التَّبَارَكُ." Suddenly I heard a man reading Surah Tabarak. I moved my tent, I went straight to Nabi alayhi salam. I said, "Oh Nabi of Allah, by mistake I pitched my tent and then I realized it was a grave and I heard Tabarak. Read Tabarak." What is the opening verses of Tabarak? الَّذِي خَلَقَ الْمَوْتَ وَالْحَيَاةَ لِيَبْلُوَكُمْ الَّذِي خَلَقَ الْمَوْتَ وَالْحَيَاةَ لِيَبْلُوَكُمْ أَيُّكُمْ أَحْسَنُ عَمَلًا وَهُوَ الْعَزِيزُ الْغَفُورُ الَّذِي خَلَقَ سَبْعَ سَمَاوَاتٍ طِبَاقًا مَا تَرَى فِي خَلْقِ الرَّحْمَنِ مِنْ تَفَاوُتٍ. How Allah introduces life. "I have created life and death to only examine you if you obey me or not." Then He says, "Look at the sky above you and look at the earth beneath you." Then Allah says, "I challenge you and I invite you. Do me a favor, don't look once, look twice, look thrice." فَرْجِعِ الْبَصَرَ كَرَّتَيْنِ. I challenge you, look at my creation repeatedly, and then come back to me if you find any fault or any flaw. Then Allah goes on to say, يَنْقَلِبْ إِلَيْكَ الْبَصَرُ خَاسِئًا. يَنْقَلِبْ إِلَيْكَ الْبَصَرُ خَاسِئًا. Your gaze will return to you defeated because my creation is flawless. Your gaze will return to you helpless. You'll give in, you'll have to throw the towel in. Where can I find fault in the creation of my Allah? كلما ألقي فيها فوج سألهم خزنتها ألم يأتكم نذير. Just ponder over what is mentioned in Surah Tabarak. Every time a group will be thrown in hell, the angels will ask them for the record. We just want to ask you, were you told? Are you aware? No, I was aware. You know about the day of Qiyamah? You were informed? 100%. أَوَلَمْ يَرَوْا إِلَى الطَّيْرِ فَوْقَهُمْ صَفَّاتٍ. You ever took out time, Allah is asking in Surah Tabarak, and look at the birds above you, how they fly. مَا يُمْسِكُهُنَّ إِلَّا الرَّحْمَانِ. مَا يُمْسِكُهُنَّ إِلَّا الرَّحْمَانِ. What is it that the law of gravity pulls you down? But the bird flies. I remember once I was in America, they took me to this place, what they call it, mystery spot, where the whole system of gravity is haywire. And ball rolls upwards. And funny things happening. Allah asks you the question, what is it that this bird flies? The law of gravity pulls you down, but the bird remains above. مَا يُمْسِكُهُنَّ إِلَّا الرَّحْمَانِ. It is only Allah that keeps that bird floating. It's only Allah that keeps that bird flying and gliding above you. So Surah Tabarak, recite Surah Tabarak. Then, what did Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam mention? He's with the Sahaba. He's out with the Sahaba. The riwayat is in Muslim Sharif. And he's mounted onto his conveyance. Suddenly the animal becomes restless. Nabi alayhi salam says, looks like this animal has seen some punishment in the grave. فَإِذَا هُنَاكَ سِتَّةُ أَقْبُرْ. Suddenly we found six graves. Nabi alayhi salam says, مَنْ يَعْرِفْ أَصْحَابَ هَذِهِ الْأَقْبُرِ. Is there anybody knows who's sleeping in this graveyard? Is there anybody knows who is resting in this grave? So one sahabi stood up, he says, I know these people. مَاتُوا فِي الْإِشْرَاكِ. These are people who died before accepting Islam. Nabi sallallahu alayhi wasallam said, إِنَّ هَذِهِ الْأُمَّةُ تُبْتَلَى فِي قُبُورِهَا. Believe me, these people are going through some grave conditions in their grave. And I and this animal have seen certain things at this moment. And if it wasn't for the fear that you stop burying your disease, I would have asked Allah to also show you what I see. لَوْلَا أَلَّا تَدَافَنُوا لَدَعَوْتُ اللَّهَ أَن يُسْمِعَكُم مِّنْ عَذَابِ الْقَبْرِ. If it wasn't for the fear that you stop burying, I would have asked Allah. Allah speaks in the Quran, النار يعرضون عليها غدوا وعشيا. That every morning and every evening, hell is opened up and it is presented before Fir'aun. This is the verse of the Quran. The people of Fir'aun are shown that what you are suffering is not the worst, the worst is yet to come. Qatada said, يُقَالُ لَهُمْ هَذِهِ مَنَازِلُكُمْ. What did Sayyidina Ali say? مَا زِلْنَا نَشُكُّ فِي عَذَابِ الْقَبْرِ حَتَّى أَنزَلَ اللَّهُ تَعَالَى أَلْهَاكُمُ التَّكَاثُرِ. People kept on doubting the reality of the grave till Allah revealed the verse, and he said, أَلْهَاكُمُ التَّكَاثُرِ. That the grave of more has blinded you. It will only be suppressed when you'll be handed over to your grave. Rabi ibn Anas says, سَنُعَذِّبُهُمْ مَرَّتَيْنِ. Where Allah says, we'll punish them twice, one will be in their grave. So anyway, Nabi alayhi salam, the riwayat is in Muslim Sharif. The animal gets excited. Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam says, calm this animal. After the animal is calm, Nabi sallallahu alayhi wasalam says, listen to me, my sahaba. تَعَوَّذُوا بِاللَّهِ مِنْ عَذَابِ النَّارِ. Ask Allah protection from the punishment of hell. Sahaba said, نَعُوذُ بِاللَّهِ مِنْ عَذَابِ النَّارِ. We ask Allah protection from the fire of hell. Then he said, تَعَوَّذُوا بِاللَّهِ مِنْ عَذَابِ الْقَبْرِ. Be emphatic and ask Allah protection from the punishment of the grave. We said, we ask Allah protection from the punishment of the grave. He then said, تَعَوَّذُوا بِاللَّهِ مِنْ فِتْنَةِ مِنَ الْفِتَنِ مَا ظَهَرَ مِنْهَا وَمَا بَطَنَ. Ask Allah protection from every evil, the hidden and the apparent. We said, we ask Allah protection. Then he said, تَعَوَّذُوا بِاللَّهِ مِنْ فِتْنَةِ الْمَسِيحِ الدَّجَّالِ. Ask Allah protection from the fitna of Dajjal. Now what is the greatest reason that leads to the punishment in the grave? This is a sad reality. He held the hand of his beloved wife Maymuna. He said, Ya Maymunatu, oh my beloved wife Maymuna, let me tell you why people will suffer in the grave the most. Inna ashadda adab al qabri. The greater portion of the torment of the grave will be because of two crimes. One is because of backbiting, and one is negligence with regards to urine drops. One is negligence with regards to urine drops. I have been told, and I say this out of concern, that at the Jum year, many of our Muslims frequent this place. They tend to attend a place where to start off, people are semi-nude, if not totally nude. The Prophet ﷺ said, لا تنظر إلى فخذ حي ولا ميت. Don't look at the thigh of a living nor a deceased. Look at the level of haya we've been taught. She is deceased. She is a corpse. She is late. She is old. She is wrapped. Yet we put an additional cover over the grave when she's nowhere inside. What did Aisha Siddiqa say? When Nabi alayhi salam passed away, I would go to the grave and stand by the grave. At times, sitting next to the grave, my eyes would close and I would sleep because it was my room. It was my husband. Then my father Abu Bakr passed away. I would enter the grave. One side was my father, one side was my husband. But then Umar passed away. I never entered my room without veiling myself because a stranger was buried. One riwayat, my Nabi said, my daughter Fatima, she is so modest. When she will stand up, an announcer will announce, drop your gazes, Fatima wants to walk. Entire hashar will be compelled to drop. Today, when the bride walks in, if your gazes are dropped, they lift their gazes. In she comes in. And then the girl singing aside. And what is the beauty? The Quran, the hadith says that Fatima, and she will stand up, the entire hashar. And who was Fatima? Kafa biki sharafan. Kafa biki sharafan. Antakuni sayyidata nisa'i ahli al-jannah. Fatima, it is enough virtue for you that you are the queen of the woman of Jannah. So she comes to Nabi alayhi salam, who is in the throes of death, and she gets emotional. She sees the pain. Aisha radiallahu anha said, prior to seeing the demise of Nabi alayhi salam, I always had the notion that if a person died with ease, then he is a very lucky person. And if a person went through a bit of pain and difficulty, then that's an unpleasant death. But my theory changed because I seen the extent of the perspiration on the body of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, knowing very well that there couldn't be a greater human. I was convinced that the very theory of death was challenging. So Fatima says, I came, I seen how he was crying. What was Nabi alayhi salam's words? Laysa ala abiki karabun ba'da al-yawm. Oh my daughter Fatima, you seen your father crying a lot, but believe me, this is the last you've ever seen your father crying. After he takes his last breath, it's only peace, it is the end of all difficulties. Today, unfortunately, it is the other way around. So it's comforts and luxury in this world. Pain starts when our eyes close. Pain starts when our eyes close. What did the Prophet ﷺ say? Istanzihu min al-bawl. Abstain from urine drops. How sad a reality that how many Muslims use the urinals. It is inconceivable for me. Literally inconceivable that as Muslims we understand how conscious we are of purity. The Prophet ﷺ says negligence towards urine drops will cause you the greatest punishment in the grave. Half of us unfortunately cannot squat and relieve ourselves, which is the correct way, which is the manner of the... Scientifically again they will tell you that is the best way because there's no contact with the body and germs etc. But from the perspective of the Prophet ﷺ, today unfortunately sitting in the washroom, or like one person, you know, in the States they call it the restroom. So why you don't get place to rest anywhere else? That's the only place to rest. The restroom. Be conscious of that. The second thing the Prophet ﷺ said, ghiba. Ghiba. Because of backbiting, this will cause you major problems in your grave. Really speaking, brothers, I can speak about much more about the qabr. The only thing that I am saying this year is that we become conscious. When Hazrat Amr ibn As radiallahu anhu was in the throes of death, his son came to him. Now make no mistake, Amr ibn As was the Fatiha Misr, the conqueror of Egypt. There's a brilliant book written on his entire life and how he conquered, and known as Fatiha Misr. You know, when he conquered Egypt, and amongst the many things that the setbacks, one was the strange practice that the people had with River Nile. That they would sacrifice a young girl, throw her in the water, and then the water would flow. And when he walked in there, these were rulers once upon a time. He said, this practice will not remain. Now look at their authority. He then writes to Umar. He says, Umar, we have a problem here. We have a stumbling block here. This was the usual practice that they would sacrifice a girl. Umar said, إِنَّ الْإِسْلَامَ يَهْدِمُ مَا كَانَ قَبْلَ. Islam is out to refute and to destroy all these practices. So how do we get water? Umar said, okay, I write a letter to the water. Look at that. Today we can't write a letter to our children. We can't write a letter to our children. We've got to be selective and we don't know how they're going to respond. We can't communicate with our wives. We can't We can't issue a decree, we can't issue a command. The tone has to be polite, the attitude has to be passive, the approach must be gentle, it must be tough. He wrote to the water. Min Amir al-Mu'mineen Umar ibn al-Khattab, and this is in Hayat al-Sahaba. From Umar ibn al-Khattab to the River Nile. In kunta tajri min qiblik fala tajri. Listen, if you flow by your own accord, then for Allah's sake don't flow. We don't need your water. And if you're flowing by the will of Allah, I ask him. He told Amr ibn As, you receive my note, drop it in. He was out in battle, he received the letter. He was out in Medina, the Sahaba were out. They wrote to him and they said, we need reinforcement. He sent three Sahaba. We're in the history of, he sent reinforcement. So people asked him three, he said, these three people have Allah and His Nabi in their life totally. If you got them, Allah's help is with them. And if they don't have Allah, then regardless of their numbers, Allah is not with them. Never did this ummah win on numbers. Three people as reinforcement. So the approach was to, anyway, Amr ibn As radiallahu anhu is in the throes of death. Then he starts crying. So his son tells him, Ama basharaka Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam bi kaza wa kaza. Oh my father, what you crying? And I heard so many times the Prophet of Allah said, Jannat is yours. He said, yes, my son, but that's one side of it. There's another side. You don't know about it. You don't know about it. We all have a negative past. We have an evil past. And may Allah don't ever reveal it to anyone. None of us are proud of our wrong. This is the mercy of Allah. In fact, in one riwayat, I read the kindness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that a person will appear before Allah. And then his book of deeds will be presented. Then he'll start going through his good deeds. And he'll start rejoicing as he'll read his good deeds. And Allah will say, if I don't accept it, he'll say, Allah, that's an hour. You're hitting me with another number. Yeah. Allah, I know you'll accept it. Allah, I know you'll accept it. So Allah will say, go, I've accepted everything. He'll fall into sajda. Outside people will say, Subhanallah, look at this man. Then he'll get up again. Then he'll start seeing his sins. His face will turn pale. His eyes will become moist. His heartbeat will increase. He'll start perspiring. Allah will, of course, Allah knows everything. Allah will say, I have forgiven it. I have forgiven it, my son. And don't scream so that others don't know you've made this mistake. Then he'll fall in sajda again. People from the outside will say, look at this man, he's only done good. He's only making shukr. Not realizing the first gratitude was in acceptance of the good actions. The latter gratitude was on the pardon of his sins. Such is the kindness of Allah. Such is the kindness of Allah. So anyway, he'll say, oh my son, I have three errors. There was an error in my life where I hated Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam the most prior to Islam. You know, Allah has given us this opportunity. I came across a quotation in Ibn Abi Dunya makes mention on the strength of Yazid ibn Nu'ama that there was an epidemic that broke out in one Muslim place and one young girl passed away in this epidemic. فَلَقِيَهَا أَبُوهَا بَعْدَ مَوْتِهَا. And this is very, very important, brothers. Her father seen her in a dream after she passed away. And he always had the passion to know. I mentioned this to you, but let me say it again. Last year when I was in the States, then one day I spoke about the punishment of the grave. And whenever I visit any place, then I make it a point to visit the graveyard. Whichever country, routinely, amongst all the people, one is to visit the pious of the locality and one is to visit the cemetery. I try my level best to make these two visits in every country, every town, visit the graveyard, make dua. So anyway, I was giving the talk and in the crowd, there was a big audience. This was in California. I seen one brother in the crowd. He was literally sobbing. So after the program was over, I went away. My host came to me. He says, you know what, my friend's got a problem and he wants to talk with you. So I said, no problem. Tomorrow after Taraweeh, I'll go to his house. So he agreed, and after Taraweeh, I went with him. We sat down in the car. I can still picture distinctly, the whole picture is before me. We sat down in the car and we started driving towards his house. A very well respected, dignified, matured, composed human. Obviously, he was very emotional. He started crying. He said, let me just take you back a few years and tell you the whole picture. I came here to America about 30 years ago. My children were born here. Alhamdulillah, I have a good established practice here. We prospered. I had so many children. I lost one son last year at the age of 24. I said, okay, right now I am understanding what's happening. He said, he then took me into the house, took me to his room, and he started crying. I pacified him. I tried to, calm him down. He said, I'm not crying over that he's gone. That was the will of Allah. He had to go when the time Allah decided. But I'm very, very hurt. I brought him to this land and I gave him everything but deen. And really, Allah be my witness, my burning desire is not, if I've given one choice, my choice is not that my son must be revived. My choice is, or my desire is, that my son must be in peace. But there's an inner feeling that haunts me continuously, because in my whole life I never told him about Allah. I gave him everything. We lived here the most comfortable life. Tragically here, he showed me in Fremont, this is where the accident happened. He was coming back, it was this day, and with his friends, and he passed away. But the thing that haunts me, and he said, since then, I started reading the Quran, and I started reading about the grave. And I cry every single day. 3 years have passed, I cry every single day. And my desire is, if Allah can ever show me my son, and I just need to know, how does he fare? Where is he by Allah? He then took me to the place where he sat, the place where he slept, the place where he ate. And obviously, like any father would, life would never be the same. Life would never, you know, like someone said, you will live on, you'll move on, but you won't literally be there. So I comforted him, I consoled him, and I told him the beauty of Islam. So anyway, this person says, my daughter died in the epidemic, and after she passed away, I seen her in a dream. So I told her, Ya bunayyatu akhbirini anil akhirah. Oh my daughter, tell me, what is this life of akhirat? Tell me, what is this life of akhirah? So she tells me in the dream, Qadimna ala amrin azim. Oh my father, it is a different world altogether. It is a different world altogether. I remember the first time when I was still studying, I was must have been 16, 17 years when I completed my third year, and my first trip I went overseas to Australia for Taraweeh. And you know, first trip outside, adventurous, what it is. It's now phoning back home, what you've seen, you're talking of, you know, pre-94. So to see people with fair skin cleaning the roads itself was, wow, does this happen in the world? You're coming from an apartheid background. It was like something inconceivable for me. He says, oh my dad, we are in a different land. But then these words of hers left me thinking. She said, نَعْلَمُ وَنَعْمَلُ وَأَنْتُمْ تَعْمَلُونَ وَلَا تَعْمَلُونَ. But we can't perform. Perform it, don't it. My father, we understand it, but we can't perform it. You can perform the deed, but you don't understand it. Suffice to say, لَتَسْبِيحَةٌ أَوْ رَكْعَةٌ خَيْرٌ مِنَ الدُّنْيَا وَمَا فِيهَا. Give me a credit of one subhanallah, it is more precious to me than the whole world. Suffice to say, one subhanallah. You know, one scholar gave the best example regarding the grave. He says, it's like a person goes fishing. And then a lot of people fish, some people fish for to eat the fish. Some what they fish for the challenge, for the fight. The other day I met a brother, he opened up another shop and I said, are you, he said, no, I'm just for the challenge I'm opening it. I said, boy, there's enough challenges in life, man. Huh? Do you need to put more challenges in your life? Maybe take another wife. I told you that article that I read. There's good news and bad news. The good news is that married men live longer than single men. But the bad news is that married men are more willing to die. I won't say more, my wife's got a speaker in the kitchen now. Yeah, subhanallah, what was I speaking? Speaking about the incident, some people do it for the sake of a challenge. What a beautiful example. The fisherman comes, he casts the rod, subhanallah. Look at the vision. وَتِلْكَ الْأَمْثَالُ نَضْرِبُهَا لِلنَّاسِ وَمَا يَعْقِلُهَا إِلَّا الْعَالِمُونَ. He casts the rod. He's got the bait hanging. The policeman on top. One fish comes advancing to the bait. 10 other fish surround him. Hey, don't eat. Don't fall for this. This is a trap. What do you mean a trap, man? It's beautiful food. No. This is a trap, my brother. What's the trap like? Listen, if you bite, there's a man sitting outside. He pulls you out. As soon as you are pulled out, you die immediately to start off. That's the lightest penalty. You drop into his car, into the trunk. You're taken home. His wife then fries you in boiling hot oil. There are 8 people that sit on a table with 36 teeth and they grind you to pieces. Okay, wait, I'll do my research and I'll get back to you. So he leaves the bait, he goes swimming in the water. He goes, he comes back. Hey, there's no fisherman, there's no rod, there's no teeth, there's no oil. But it's outside the water. How are you looking for it in the water? My Nabi said it's going to happen in the grave when your eyes close. You'll never understand it in this world. So now it depends on this fish to decide. The fish, either it makes the right call or the wrong, but the consequences are grave. It's tempting. I mentioned this last week when we went hunting. So, you know, routinely with the few places, whenever we go for lectures, then after that they take us hunting. And not that I shot anything, you know, blank shots. Although I was very close the last time. As we walking in, I seen this the last time on the game farm, and I seen it last week again. I seen it again on the same game farm. I seen few, you know, dead cattle. So I asked the owner of the farm, I said, "Now, Afisab, what is this?" He said, "Maulana, you're not going to believe this." He took up a green blade of grass, tulip. He said, "This grass is greener than the other, but it is dead poison for this cattle. The temptation is it's green. If this cattle eat it, in 6 hours they die instantly. We try and familiarize them that it's poisonous as soon as they come in when we get new cattle. And then again, you know the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, look at the wisdom. People ask, why this? Goat is permissible for the females, forbidden for the male. If the goat eats it, nothing happens. If the sheep eat it, nothing happens. If a cow eats it, it dies immediately. Then the challenge of the whole thing is, it's greener than other grass. What did the Prophet, immediately this hadith came to my mind. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Ad-dunya hulwatun khadira." This world is sweet and green. These are the words of the Prophet. So this is the challenge for the cattle. That you remind them, you warn them, but again, because it's green, they advance towards it. Immediately they get constipated. It then leads to excruciating pain and you cannot sustain them. They collapse, and he says, we try and slaughter them in time if they happen to eat it. You can't stop the growth of this tulip, and you can't stop the cows. And in this way, he said, this year we lost 10 cattle because of this. So again, the temptation is green. So that example of the fisherman is really an apt example for us to reflect. Let me end with an incident of Amr ibn As radiallahu anhu. In the throes of death, he tells his son, "I had 3 errors. One was the era of absolute darkness when I hated the Prophet of Allah. And if I had to die in that condition, my son, then obviously I would have gone to hellfire. ثُمَّ جَعَلَ اللَّهُ الْإِسْلَامَ فِي قَلْبِي." Then Allah favored me with Islam. And I came to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and I accepted. And while he was alive, that was my best era. I wish I died while he was alive. You know, sometimes you see yourself going through different emotions. And when you see yourself dropping in piety, you wish you would have gone, or you had passed away at the time when you were in the climax of your piety. You were at the best of your spirituality. But obviously time is decided by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Then after the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam passed away, ثُمَّ وُلِّينَا أَشْيَا, the luxuries of this world open up. So really, my son, I don't know how is Allah going to judge me, but I have 2 requests to you after I die. When I pass away, the first thing, I don't want people to come and flatter me here. No, I don't want people to come and unduly praise me that he was such a man, or what a great human, what a person. I mentioned, you know, my ustad used to always say that generally women will praise their husbands on 2 occasions. The first is when she is proposed to him before she got married to him. You know, I heard so much about him. You know, what a great guy. Everybody has given me good words. He's a wonderful person. And the second is when his janazah is lifted from the house. "Your late father was a good boy." I say it with tears in my eyes. Tell the man when he's alive. Tell the man when he's alive. Does it take the death of a man to say your father was a good man? Praise the man when he's alive. Say a kind word to him when he's alive. Give him flowers, not at his grave, when he's alive. I don't want people to come and praise me unduly. Because, you know, a person was walking, someone insulted him. He said, "Listen, my brother, No offense to your criticism. There is a bridge between me and Jannat. If I make it across the bridge, I don't care what you say because Allah considered me successful. But if I fail to cross that bridge, trust me, I'm worse than what you said. Because the crucial moment is this bridge. If I made it, it doesn't make a difference to you. If the university recognizes you and you got official certification, now one ordinary person says, no, I don't believe you're a doctor. Good luck to you, my brother. Good luck. In fact, in Arabic, they say, إِذَا أَتَتْكَ مَذَمَّتِي مِن نَاقِسٍ فَهِيَ الشَّهَادَةُ لِي بِأَنِّي كَامِلُونَ. When an incompetent person frowns on me, then that's a reflection on my competence. Because he's not a qualified man that is frowning on me. He's an incompetent man. He himself is not skilled. If it's a skilled man that he's got an objection against me, then there's merit. But he's not skilled. So his objection is a proof of my perfection. إِذَا أَتَتْكَ مَذَمَّتِي مِن نَاقِسٍ فَهِيَ الشَّهَادَةُ لِي بِأَنِّي كَامِلُ. So I don't want people to come and praise me and flatter me. That's the first thing. Then he said, oh my son, after you've lowered me into my grave, فَمْكُثُوا عِنْدَ قَبْرِي قَدْرَ مَا يُنْحَرُ جُزُورٌ وَيُقْسَمُ لَحْمُهَا. Stand by my grave. I'm asking you as my son. Stand there for the duration that a camel is slaughtered and the meat is distributed. And recite La ilaha illallah excessively. By virtue of your spirituality, it will empower me and it will easen it for me to answer my angel swiftly. That's the request of a dying father to his son. Not, my son, please take care of the shop. You know, I put my sweat, I brought this business up. You know what I did, you know what I brought up to put this business in this place. That were not the words, that were not the words. But rather the words, oh my son, you stand by my grave and remember me by my grave. Really, my brother, if you've left behind children that know where you are buried, then you've left behind a handsome legacy. But if you left behind children who only know where your money lies and don't know where you lie, you've wasted your life and you've made the biggest blunder. Forgive me if I say it crude. If you left behind children who know where to visit your grave and they know where their father is buried, then there is something good you've left behind. Otherwise, I'm afraid they will continue with your evil practices and you will suffer in the grave. Then he said, Allahumma innaka amartana fa'asayna wa nahaytana faman tahayna wa la yasahuna illa afwak. Allahumma la qawiyun fa'antasir wa la bariyun fa'a'tadir wa la mustankirun bal mustaghfirun. Allah, you told me to do a lot of things, but unfortunately I didn't live up to it. Allah, you prohibited me, but I did not abstain. Allah, it's your mercy and not my actions. Then he said, Allah, I'm not strong that I can argue with the angel. Who you? Why you came? That was Sayyidina Musa alayhi salam. In the riwayat of Muslim Sharif, when the angel of death came to take out his soul, the riwayat of Muslim, لَقَمَ وَجْهَهُ. Musa alayhi salam slapped him when his eye fell out. He went back to Allah, أَرْسَلْتَنِي إِلَىٰ عَبْدٍ لَا يُرِيدُ الْمَوْتِ. Allah, I need to report back to you. We had a strange happening today. Reporting live. What happened? Allah, you send me to a man who doesn't want to die. Allah said, that is my servant Musa. He wasn't aware that you're the angel, but go to him. And then tell him you are the angel of death and tell him I have sent you. And then tell him, we give him an option. يَضَعُ يَدَهُ عَلَى مَتَنِ ثَوْرٍ فَلَهُ بِمَا غَتَّتْ يَدُهُ بِكُلِّ شَعْرَةٍ سَنَى. This is exclusive to him. If he wants, he can put his hand on the back of a bull. And every strand of hair that he touches, he will be granted extension of 1 year's life. Go and tell this is to Musa. Number one, we don't get this. Number two, if we get it, we'll look for the most hairy cow. So he came to Musa in the riwayat of Muslim Sharif. Allah has given you this choice. Musa said, okay, I will use my hands, put it on a cow, live for so long, then what? He said, then you still have to die. You still have to die. What did Allah say? يَوَدُّ أَحَدُهُمْ لَوْ يُعَمَّرُ أَلْفَ سَنَةٍ وَمَا هُوَ بِمُزَحْزِحِهِ مِنَ الْعَذَابِ أَن يُعَمَّرُ. Live for 1,000 years, it won't save you from your torment, you still suffer. So he said, if I have to die at that stage, rather now. And then he asked Allah, that, oh Allah, bring me close to this sacred land of Baytul Muqaddas. And Nabi alayhi salam told his Sahaba, if I was there at that location, at the foot of this hill, at the foot of a red hill, I would have shown you the location of the grave of Musa alayhi salatu was salam. So anyway, he said, Allah, I'm not strong that I'm going to engage your angels and I'm going to, who sent you, where are you coming from? No, Allah, I'm not strong, I can't argue. Wala bariyun, and I'm not innocent that I can prove my innocence. Saying this, he read the kalima and he took his last breath. Really, brothers, I made my talk exclusive to the qabr. We've heard the virtue of this night, we heard the speciality of this night, but it's time we start reflecting on this grave. We need to take it more seriously. We pass by the graveyard daily, routinely, yet we don't reflect over it. In one riwayat of Bukhari, there was a janazah that passed. Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam stood up. Sahaba said, it's a non-Muslim. Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said, but it is symbolic to death. It's death, it's a disease, it's a corpse, it's leaving this world, it's a sign. End of the day, it's death. It's got to bring a halt. It's got to just jam your movement. It's got to just interrupt your plan. It's just got to abruptly, you know, end your actions of the day. Unfortunately, that has not happened. Hey, yeah, shame, tragic. Anyway, so we're meeting on Monday, eh? We're meeting on Monday. Finish, we've buried the topic, gone, and it's moved on. It's, you know, when the reality of life, if it had to stop for anyone, it would have stopped for Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, but life carried on. If life had to stop, it would have stopped for Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, but it carried on. Aisha radiallahu anha, when she lost her brother Abdul Rahman, and then she was in Medina, and he passed away in Makkah, and when she went for Hajj, she said, on the way, I'll just pass by the grave of my brother. I wasn't there, I was in Medina, so I could not see the death of my brother and be there for the funeral of my brother. So when she came by the grave of her brother, she sang few couplets. She said, وَكُنَّا كَنَدْمَا نَيْ جَزِيمَةَ حِقْبَةً مِنَ الدَّهْرِ حَتَّى قِيلَ لَنْ يَتَصَدَّعَا فَلَمَّا تَفَرَّقْنَا كَأَنِّي وَمَالِكَ لِتُولِجْتِمَاعٍ لَمْ نَبِتْ لَيْلَةً مَعَا. My brother and myself were like the two ministers of the king Jazima, who ruled for such a long period that people said they are inseparable. That is how bonded I was to my brother. But then out of the two ministers, one died and the other one had to live. And then life carried on for him in such a way that he used to say, it is as if I never met my brother. It is as if I never met. Life carried on for him. After the death of someone, just the name will make you emotional. Then you'll get grips, you'll be able to hear the name, but you won't be able to see his clothes. Then a time will come, you will pass by and you say, my late brother with a smile on your face is buried in this graveyard. So life will carry on, my brother. It didn't stop for him, it didn't stop for me, it will not stop for anyone. I will be lowered and I will have to answer. We make dua to the Almighty Allah that He make us conscious of our qabr. He make us amongst those people that starts developing their graves. It's time we start furnishing our grave. You know, how many times people won't move in that house just because the paving is not done. Everything is done, the paving is not done. One remote in the gate is not fitted. No, everything must be done. The house must be furnished. And we want to walk into a grave which we know what is the condition. We know how it has been neglected. Our grave is what we make of it. So it's time we furnish our grave. It is time we brighten our grave. Allah make us amongst those fortunate people. Recite Durud Sharif. Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen. Wa salatu wa salamu ala ashrafil anbiya'i wal mursaleen. سيدنا ومولانا محمد وعلى آله وأصحابه أجمعين. اللهم اجعل اجتماعنا هذا اجتماعا مرحوما، وتفرقنا من بعده تفرقا معصوما، ولا تجعل فينا ولا منا ولا معنا شقيا ولا محروما. اللهم حبب إلينا الإيمان وزينه في قلوبنا، وكره إلينا الكفر والفسوق والعصيان. اللهم اجعلنا من الراشدين. ربنا هب لنا من أزواجنا وذرياتنا قرة أعين، واجعلنا للمتقين إماما. اللهم اجعل أولادنا برا تقيا، وأنبتهم في الإسلام نباتا حسنا. اللهم بارك لنا في رجب وشعبان، وبلغنا إلى رمضان. اللهم تقبل صلاتنا وصيامنا وقيامنا وركوعنا وسجودنا، وتقبل منا صالح أعمالنا، وجعلنا من المقبولين في الدنيا والآخرة. اللهم إنا نسألك من خير ما سألك منه عبدك ونبيك محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم، ونعوذ بك من كل شر ما استعاذك منه عبدك ونبيك محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم. أنت المستعان وعليك البلاغ، ولا حول ولا قوة إلا بالله العلي العظيم. سبحان ربك رب العزة عما يصفون، وسلام على المرسلين، والحمد لله رب العالمين.